क्षेत्र में हुई। अनुजा चौहान एक ऐसा नाम जो कि किसी भी परिचय का मोहताज नहीं है। एडवर्टाइजिंग क्षेत्र में काम करने के दौरान आपने कई पॉपुलर एड कैंपेन्स पर भी काम किया, जैसे कि नथिंग ऑफिशियल अबाउट इट, ये दिल मांगे मोर, ओए पब्ली, डर के आगे जीत और लिव इट अभी। आपकी सभी सफल किताबों पर फिल्म निर्माण की बात भी चल रही है। आपसे बातचीत करेंगी श्री भास्कर की है प्रेरणा सहानी।
सो लेट अस स्टार्ट। अनुजा मैम, आप बताएं कि राइट फ्रॉम एडवर्टाइजिंग यू नो टू राइटिंग, बिकॉज वी रेड दैट यू नो योर हस्बैंड गेव यू अ बुक एंड दैट इज व्हाट लर्ड यू टू एडवर्टाइजिंग, टेल अस समथिंग अबाउट योर जर्नी प्रायर टू राइटिंग इन एडवर्टाइजिंग एंड यू गेव अस सच ब्यूटीफुल कैंपेन्स इन वन लैंग्वेज।
Yeah, actually, I used to write a lot when I was, you know, in school, and it was just something I did for fun, you know, that typical in the house, in the school kind of writing. And then only on the balbuta of my writing, extracurricular activities quota, I got into Miranda House, like scram, managed to get in. And I was doing economics there. And again, you do economics because it's that typical course you choose because options ko mere rakhne chahiye, eco karo, bargain se. And drifting through college, like only in the 40s, 41-42% and sort of doing nothing much. And then I met my husband, who at that time was my boyfriend, and he told me, you know, you should do advertising. And I didn't realize that advertising is a proper full-fledged field. I thought people don't magically these ads come on TV. So then, you know, it was a big realization that this is actually an industry and people do this and people get paid to do this. To sit around and do writing like humko binis manta, which is what was coming on TV those days. And he gave me this book, David Ogilvy's book, it's called On Advertising. And it was a real eye-opener. And I thought, achha, iska thoda eco bhi hai, you could say marketing, whatever. And of course, lots of chance to be, you know, do the kind of things I like to do. So that was it. So it was quite a epiphany at that point. And bahut aasani hota hai, bahut aasan hota hai advertising mein naukri, you know, to secure a job. You just go to the agencies and they're so desperate, like they have signs that say trespassers will be briefed. They catch you and it's going to go. So when you go, it's easy to get it, it's hard to keep it because it is very grueling work. And when you're a young person in an ad agency, they really work you like a dog. So that was it, that's how I got into it.
Yeah, and then 17 long years between
the two. It didn't feel long. I worked in the same agency for 17 years. I had 3 children along the way. And it was great fun. It passed really fast. I really enjoyed what I did. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then what is the difference, like if you compare your advertising job vis-a-vis your writing job? Because one is absolute teamwork. Mm-hmm. And one is, you know, when you're all by yourself, you're writing for yourself, yeah, and others. Yeah. So what's the difference?
See, advertising is a very tight box. It's a very tight of box. It's usually 30 seconds long, or if you're really a big brand, 1 minute long. 1 minute is like, wow, itna bada budget hai. You're selling something. You're selling a chip or a cola or a phone or a health drink or whatever it is, the brand that you have. So there's a very tight story that needs to be told in that 30 seconds. Something has to be sold. There's some celebrity coming in, there's 50 takes on it, main karunga, main wo karunga, all that. There's a budget, there's a client. Client ke piche there's a research that has to be done, and by the time that thing comes by, whatever you wrote, you don't recognize what you wrote. So everyone has done their own thing on it, and then the thing comes back, it's like you want to disown it. It's like some child you don't want to own up to. So it is collaborative, and so then it's great fun, but there are a lot of constrictions. And also, the more promotions you get, you become more and more of an, you know, like a management person and less of a real writer. And at one point I looked around the office and I was like, mereko sabki mummy kisne banaya? It's like just, it becomes more of a managerial post. So it was more like a bit to return to hardcore writing, and to, which is actually what I got into advertising to in the first place. And also I got drunk on that sense of power. Ki mera mac hai, main khol ke aaj kisi ko maar do. Or kisi ka main kuch bhi kar do, it's all up to me. It's so that absolute power got me really drunk and very excited. So that's the difference. And so I guess as I got more frustrated in advertising, this really made me feel very happy and youthful and bright and happy about writing again.
Okay, so let us talk about like what your mom-in-law, Margaret Ma'am, who's so close to Rajasthan, you know, what stories did she reveal to you? One or two stories if you could narrate, you know, that really helped you in building up the character of your story. Because I could figure out, you know, in Indira Gandhi, Nehru, Rahul Gandhi.
See, Mama came to Rajasthan much after this book was written.
Yes, yes.
So, yeah, so that doesn't really have much to do with it. But with her, I mean, I just did some campaigning with her. Beyond everything else, I just thought it was so hilarious. You know, I thought it was just, there was a real funny side to it. And when I was writing this book, that was even before the whole Anna Hazare thing and, you know, normal people getting involved in politics, Aam Aadmi Party, none of that had happened. So politics was still a holy cow. It wasn't for people like us. We didn't get into it. Maybe we had some Vibho Tauji or some grandmother ji who was in it, but people like all very multinational kind of people. You know, it wasn't something you did. And for others, so the perception of the politician was very much, you know, like this very shady, grey, stereotypical character who runs orphanages and then he's a pedophile. You know, I mean, like, there's like a very typical take that you'd see in the movies and stuff. So I just thought that there was place to be optimistic and there was place to be happy about it and say that, yeah, okay, I mean, I'll get my hands dirty, I'll go there and do something. So I didn't want to write about young people in politics. And of course, the whole circus of it, which is fantastic and great fun.
Have your friends or, you know, the relatives or the people whom you have actually, you know, given some specific characters in the book, in Flesh and Blood, they have recognized themselves, you know, that you've coined them?
No, but there are lots of people, like, my mom-in-law has, I mean, like, she's done these things. It's either her or it's a story that she's told me. Like, there's a person who's made a complete kleptomaniac in charge of the campaign fund. How is that smart? You know, this person is in charge of all your finances and you know this person's a kleptomaniac and this person steals things, to put it very simply. Why is that person in charge? She did used to have somebody who followed, it was always very shady, tell me, anything for you, madam, what do you want? I don't know this. What do you want me to do? I will do whatever you want. And it was like, you see, I was so fervent and just a little bit like very sexual, the way he would offer his services to me early in the morning. Aapko kya karna hai? Aapko kahan jana hai? Main kaise seva karu? Like, aap mat karo seva. So, you know, those kinds of things, I think, one is very privileged to get access to when these things happen. So it's lovely. And I'm a manic eavesdropper. I eavesdrop all the time. And you overhear some juicy conversations. And if you're on a political campaign, you get lovely juice. And of course, if you write fiction, of course, you change it and you mix it and you mash it. So nobody hopefully recognizes themselves.
So, did
Margaret
Ma'am actually read this whole book? Or, you know,
she read it. She read the whole thing.
She pinpointed that this needs to be edited. This should be here.
No. The really unsettling thing was that she wasn't fooled by any of my camouflage. Okay. She got everything. And I told her, you're going to get into trouble because she's saying the real names of people who have disguised very subtly. And she's saying, but so and so. And I'm like, no, that's not so and so, mama. That is, you know, that is the fictional character.
Rahul Mahajan was.
Yeah, who's out there? I mean, like, what's Rahul Mahajan? But yeah, so it was stuff like that. So she got absolutely everything. And the other thing was that she said, I wish I had also such a hot young prince to stand against me. That never happened. I only get some, whatever that man's name is, whoever the person she would stand against. So she was a little wistful about how she never got to, you know, play it that way.
Okay, tell me something, like, how much time does it take, you know, to figure out the character and flesh and blood? Because, and then, you know, differentiate the previous book from the upcoming one or the work, whatever is the work in progress. How do you differentiate? Because people could find a lot of similarity between your first book and the second book. Mm-hmm. Because it's actually you, your own portrayal and your own experiences, your own narratives. So, like, how do you create a sense of differentiation apart from the plot in the form?
See, I think usually whenever a character comes to your head, there'll be something about them that you like. You know, there'll be one thing and you'll say, this person's basic motivation comes from this. You know, so that will be the point of difference. There'll be someone, either be a particular goal that person has or a particular flaw that person has, and then the rest of that, that particular flower will bloom from there. You know, like Shanu, like in bars, he's short. That's his problem. He's a short guy. And so he has all the cockiness and all the insecurity that a short guy will have, you know. So it sort of radiates out of that, or what you want. Like in this, so I think that comes in, and then the layers add on. And sometimes you're writing someone and they feel very vanilla, and you're saying, I need something to make this person tick. And then you'll find something at some point or the other. Like if I see half of girls and Chachiji is obsessed with Jambu Kona, she's like, it's a theme. And then you need to find that thing and then say, ah, this is this kind of woman. And then once you've got that, then you know how to add her and place her and give her those things. So, and it's a bit of a voice of self-discovery in any case. You know, you write someone down, you don't know where they're going to go. And then somewhere they start going in a particular way, and then you sort of figure it out. And of course, it's so much about the people you meet and the people you know, or the people you find amusing, or you may have read in a book a certain character who you felt could have been much bigger than they are in that novel, and you sort of steal a little and say, it's for my polisher. So it's that sometimes, and characteristics, like very often, some characters are like certain animals, you know. Someone is cat-like, someone is, have you tried, advertising teaches you like short descriptors, you know, like someone in this book is called a Sakshat Fart, because like if a fart ever assumed human form, it would be this person, I forget what his name was. Or somebody's like, you know, like there's a guy who's described as a shami kebab, like an oily shami kebab. He's like this man sitting there wrapped in tissue because he's wearing like a crisp white kurta pajama. So I'm saying, those are little advertising tricks one learns, you know,
imageries.
And also like, and also the whole thing of like, what motivates this person? What is he really about? What's insecurity? The Jani Thakur and Pricey Thakur girls is a lover of losers. That's the main thing. You know, she's like, the Jani Thakur and lover of losers. She will always go for that. That one, you know, some langa kutta she finds. So like her favorite beetle will be Ringo Starr, because nobody likes Ringo Starr. Her favorite cricket team is going to be Bangladesh or something. So everything, that girl will go and find the biggest loser of the block. Like that's why she's called Dabbu. Her nickname is Dabbu, because the only Kapoor she likes is Randhir Kapoor. So she's like, everybody else, like, you know, Rishi and Shashi and Raj, and she's like, but Randhir Kapoor, and the name is Devjani, they call her Dabbu because of that, you know, because he's her favorite. So something like that will then tag this girl, and you know, okay, this girl is like this. And then everything else will just follow that, that first realization you have.
I think we can open the house for questions now. They would love to ask you questions. Step one, you waiting in authors, and I discussed your work. And what I find amazing is the backdrops you choose, like those by elections or cricket or Bollywood or fashion for that sense. So what other areas or what other backdrop excite you and can expect you to write a book on it? Because I find them so driving. Your main character's journey is defined by those backdrops. So any other particular backdrop that you would like to explore in the future?
Well, right now I'm very excited about the Air Force. I feel the Air Force doesn't really get its due, and whatever, even in Bollywood or popular culture, you will see a lot about the army, but you won't see much else about the other services. So, I like that. I mean, I love the whole thing of, you know, especially if you go back in time a little, when the Air Force and the armed forces are still very posh, in a sense, like you had royalty in the IMA and, you know, places like that. And it was still considered really cool. Nowadays, it's not that same thing. So I feel it's a slightly lost world, which I really wanted to deep dive into. And I wanted to surround myself with young men again, because Pricey Thakur girls and the house that we did, like five sisters are drowning in women. So I did really enjoy getting back into like the whole boys' zone for a while. See, as far as backdrops go, I try and pick something that will keep me interested for a year at least. Because I've been writing for a year, so it better be something I'm really excited about. Because you read the book, you'll be done in one night, 2 days, you know. I'll be living with it for a whole year, for a reason to get out of bed. So it better be something that I'm interested in, that has enough layers. And I love any kind of setting. It just gives me these conflicts of India, you know. Like that whole clash of like the hardcore traditionalists and the hypocrites and like these cutting edge Kumbu people. And all those little delicious hypocrisies and all our little kachar kachar, that's that kind of thing I really love. So whatever background gives me that, I sort of zoom into that.
Because Ginny is a real good example of how India blends with Bharat. Yeah. Lovely. The kind of English, the election and the election agents, they are lovely. The portrayal is fantastic. I mean,
there's
really, you can't stop reading this.
Each of our books, I mean, you see the way they speak, each one has a special quirk and continues throughout the book. That keeps you both together.
Yeah, you cannot. I had to finish it in 3.5 hours because I couldn't
sit
on it. You can't just, you know, shelve it. Forget about the meetings and everything.
I see
this,
all of
this, they
can't
find
it. 6 days.
See, that's what? And I spent some 48 years writing on it. It's all a complete zoo.
Good evening, Anuja. I just wanted to ask you one thing. You look ageless. I've been seeing you in quite some time now. Who would say you are a mother of three? Give us some tips. Your secrets.
I think it's just good genes, really, honestly. I haven't really done, I'm terrible at exercise. My children are all karate black belts. They're really fit. My husband's so fit. I mean, like, you know, like the bodies are hard. And all of them, all four of them in that house. And I'm like the, you know, jiggly and jewel, as they call me. So
you look 20-something, come on.
No, I'm just telling you. So I don't really have, I don't have many vices. Like, I don't smoke and I don't drink much. And it's a, when you're younger, if there are any younger ladies here, I think breastfeeding is so important. This is more or less a ladies event, so you can talk about it anywhere. I think that's so important. And the other thing which I'm maybe have got right is portion control. I find that I can't eat too much. I managed to shrink my stomach, I think. So I eat everything. But I find I can't eat too much of it. Yeah. So I'll start off with the chola vadura, I'll go for it, but I'll sort of run out of steam very fast. I won't be able to finish it. But that's it. Sorry. Don't have much to say.
I have a question. She just read about it. You beautifully mentioned about dyslexia in your book. I'm a psychotherapist, that's why I'm asking you. Was there any particular reason to mention about it? I mean, you felt somewhere somebody was going through it, and because it's not a topic which is openly spoken about even today. I'm talking about Jaipur.
Mm-hmm.
So was there any particular reason to write about it in your book?
Oh, sorry, my book, it was just a bit of a cheap pun. Because he was, you know, I mean, like while she's in the village, she's coaching this one little kid. And he doesn't go to school, he's a nabhi nikama bacha. And he's not studying, he's not applying himself. And they tell him, why do you do so badly? He says, I've got dyslexic, you know, unris, I've got this disease. And she's saying, you know, I don't think that's possible because you did well in Hindi, so you can't be dyslexic because, you know, how come, you know.
That's kind of an eye-opening, whosoever is reading it.
Huh.
It's kind of creating a small bit of awareness.
Yeah.
That's why I asked you, you know, whether you did it knowingly, unknowingly, but it is creating that kind of a bit of awareness.
See, but like, I always find that if you say something with a laugh, you're probably gonna better than if you put out a mouth sanitizer. So whatever the issue, I mean, this book has honor killings, and this book has like serious amounts of caste, and it has people who have HIV and who are being, you know, included in everything. But it's always like, you know, you're writing a funny book, it should be entertaining. And it is, I think people, you know, you get people's back up if you're trying to preach. So I don't think one should preach at all. And that stench of moral science will put everybody off the novel. So I think you have to be quite sly with your agenda.
Thank you so very much. There's a question.
I'm from Jaipur Book Lovers. And when we were discussing Indian books, all we could find were either romance books or mythology. So what kind of future do you envision for the Indian literature? The company.
Wow, I mean, that's slightly out of my syllabus. I think that everybody should read more and read more very, you know, than what they're like consuming. And because I feel that if a nation reads a lot, then it will write well. And reads a lot of what we call maybe, you know, a very kind of authors. And like you said, not just like campus romance and mythological stories, which seems to be what's selling. But So I think the emphasis needs to be on reading. I think people have started to write much before they read. Like, please read something. There was someone at the Litfest last year, I was on a panel with him, and he very proudly said, I've never read a single book. I think, yeah, what do I even say to you anymore? This conversation ends here. So, and this is at a point where, you know, my daughter posts this Instagram hashtag called Hot Dudes Reading. And the Hot Dudes Reading is so popular. There's so many pictures of men and boys reading in trains and locals and anywhere. It's like a big fantasy thing. And maybe our boys need to be told this, that, you know, a lot of things will happen for you, just, you know, stand around with a book. So I think that the emphasis really needs to be on reading much more.
So we end on another hilarious note by Anuja. This is about the grandmom, Pushpa Pandey. पिछली बार भी उन्हें भरोसा था कि द्विवेदी का पत्ता काट देंगे. उन्होंने प्रेस में भी कहा था कि वह पाखंडी, रिश्वतखोर और लालची है. उसके पाखंडी, रिश्वतखोर और लालची होने का सबूत देते हुए उन्होंने कहा था कि वह और उसका परिवार सब्जियों को छिलकों के साथ खाता है. ऐसा ब्राह्मण जो अपने बरामदे में गायों को सब्जियों के छिलके भी नहीं खिला सके, विक्टोरिया करके अच्छा नहीं है, ऐसा उन्होंने ऐलान किया.
वो लौकी का छिलका खाने वाला लौकी का छिलका खाता है,
उस लौकी का छिलका खाने वाले के बारे में जो भी कुछ कहा था सही निकला.
धन्यवाद. मैं श्री रोहित घर GM होटल मैरियट से निवेदन करूंगी कि वह अनुजा और प्रेरणा जी को यहाँ पर मोमेंटो देकर उनका अभिवादन करें.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, look at. But please. Wait.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am. Wait.
Dim lighting.
No, you're actually pretty.
Nice.
Wow, you have a nice orange one.
Thank you. All the best.
I'm like always hunting for new things.
Yeah.
You have to smile for my camera.
Yeah, of course.
There. He's got it.
Too beautiful.